And joining us in studio, Udo Fruse, independent political analyst, Oliver Dixon, a social political analyst, Tsepo Khadima, political analyst, will join us on our outside broadcast pack. And we have Sifiso Mahlangu, who is NN7 and TNA political editor. Good evening to you, gentlemen, and thanks so much for joining us. Udo, let's just start with you. Your reaction to what transpired at UJ, completely misreading the audience in this case on the part of Pravin Gordhan.
Well, there's a strategy of countrywide pockets of manipulating and campaigning against the state, against the ANC, and against President Zuma. That is, wherever you go nowadays, you find these pockets of has-beens, of wannabes, of people punching way above the weights, making noise about President Zuma and his cabinet and the inner circle of the ANC. That is common daily bread nowadays in South Africa, and most likely in the region, because people are monitoring the region. The region is monitoring South and Southern Africa very much so. But what Pravin Gordhan and BC Jonas actually said was nothing new at all. Besides the critique, they threatened, if South Africa does not do this, South Africa will suffer from that. It's a failed state policy they have. It's the typically minority groups' rights abuse of the de Klerk, Joe Slovo thing of secret sunset clauses that they are feeling protected with. That gives them the right, they believe, self-righteously, to carry on with their hot air that they continue to blow. There's absolutely nothing new that they said. Gordhan always has punched above his weight. And I would like ANN7 to invite his fellow comrades, if you can call them comrades, from Durban, from the SACP, from the Natal Indian Congress, to find out actually who really Pravin Gordhan is, because nobody really knows him. He was part of the UDF, he was part of the...
Well, he gave his political credentials in being underground and the work that they've done,
you know,
and sacrifices.
Let him show it. Let the people around him talk about him, so that you get a better and a bigger picture than what he wants to be.
Yeah. Before we go into his political credentials, just your view in the interaction going royally wrong with the UJ students. You think it's a wake up call or rude awakening for former finance minister?
Well, good evening, Cindy. And first of all, I would believe Mr. Udo Froese's analysis or assessment of Mr. Pravin Gordhan's character or political background. Or political curriculum vitae, if you will, because he's been in this game for a long time. And at the time when he was the spokesperson to Ms. Winnie Mandela, he had a lot of interactions with people in and around Mr. Gordhan's circle. So I really think what he has to say tonight opens a lot of the eyes of our mind, if I may. Today's setting was very dangerous, I think, for Mr. Gordhan. Not just politically, also physically. If anyone can get the land back in this country, it's the students. And I don't think you go to the students as you would to the working class and lie to them. Some of these students, like me, are graduates of political science. Many of them are postgraduate students, and they are readers of Marx and Lenin. They know a lot about what is happening in this country. And to go there and to have hits and slurs and think that students don't understand what is happening in this country was presumptuous of him. He really put, I think, his mouth on the line today, because the students had to call him to order and say, you promised us about fees must fall, you have not delivered. I think the one question that one of the students asked him, for me, that was the turnaround moment in today's lecture. One of the students said to Mr. Pravin Gordhan, you are speaking now because you've been fired. Mcebisi Jonas says this is a failed government. This is a leadership in crisis. But a few months ago, you were in that leadership and you cried when that leadership fired you. Why are you speaking now that you are out? So you're in a marriage and you really enjoy it, or you work for an organization and you really enjoy it. When they fire you because of reasons known to that organization, you cry and, you know, contact the CCMA because you want to hold on to your job. A day later, you hold a press conference or a public lecture and you discredit the organization that you cried to remain in. Is it just sour grapes, or is there any credibility on what Mr. Gordhan and Mr. Mcebisi Jonas were bringing at this lecture? And I'm upset to say the answer is no. They provided no resources and no solutions to this country, to the fiscus of this country.
Yeah.
But in fact, they were going to deliver a lecture on a certain family that allegedly captured the state. Once again, without any proof, without any backup evidence to say on such and such a date, this is what happens. They were going to coach these students into a regime change, into a government which would idealize Mr. Pravin Gordhan and Mr. Mqebisi Jonas. But in this incident, unlike all the memorial lectures and the memorial services where Pravin Gordhan is hailed, this did not work this afternoon, unfortunately for him.
Yeah, but and as you were saying, you need to be in tune with what is going on in the country, what the imperatives are. The students raising the very critical point around the skewed inequality, especially when it comes to the land issue. Well, go with Mr. Dixon, that this is the point what the students wanted to hear. It's 23 years into democracy, and we haven't seen a fundamental material change in the quality of life of the majority black people. And unfortunately, our speakers today missed the point, Mr. Dixon.
I think, quite importantly, Pravin Gordhan misread the room. I think he knew that he was going to speak to an audience of incredibly young people who have a very distinctive set of problems, and he needed to speak about what the political direction should be in terms of addressing those problems. And I think that was a missed opportunity to exhibit pure leadership and really explain to us why is it the case that the fiscus can't carry free education. Why is it the case that getting the land back will the land reclamation project will harm the sort of investor confidence they're speaking about and these sort of things? But I do think that there was some value in the address, some value with regards to how funds get leaked out of the fiscus, and I think those are very important things to listen to, even for young people. So his analysis on how service providers for the state often overprice the state and how that's almost always legal but unregulated and how that should change, I think that was valuable, because it is truly the case that service providers who do business with the state often overprice the state and that is some form of corruption. And oftentimes it's the form of corruption that is seen as clean and passes audits and stuff. And I think we really need to take that into cognizance and really change our attitudes and think about how we do business with the state, especially young people who are going to go into the business sector and start doing business with the state. And I think that was particularly important in that conversation there.
Yeah, but what about the omission? Sorry, Mr. Dixon, the omission in terms of the EFSA apartheid era bailout, the collusion in various sectors of the economy that has stripped even more and continues to do so from the fiscus. What about the omission of that kind of detail?
We can actually lambast Pravin Gordhan about that quite strongly so, because that's a very important conversation that he's just not having, and not having adequately in the places where he does sort of kind of have it. But I don't think that's a problem exclusive to Pravin Gordhan. I think that's a problem that stems across our administration, and not just our administration now, but our previous administrations as well. This is something that's been known to the state since Nelson Mandela's administration, Thabo Mbeki's administration, Kgalema Motlanthe's administration, and absolutely nothing has been done about it by any of those preceding presidents. And I think that's indicative of the fact that white capital is so ubiquitous that it shuts out any sort of conversation about apartheid sort of looting and that sort of thing. So I don't think it's we should solely and holistically only blame Pravin Gordhan, because even our current finance minister doesn't want to speak about it. Even he called the public protector to order when he was on his international tour in America trying to speak to investors. And I think that's just a demonstration of how weak our political will and how weak our political direction actually is in terms of reformation.
All right, the natural ambience there is actually overshadowing your voice, Mr. Dixon, so we're going to have to let you go. So social political analyst Oliver Dixon, and Udo, I mean, we saw Pravin Gordhan almost being apologetic to say, look, under the circumstances, I could only do so much, when he was questioned on the issue of, number one, opening the trade up in the textile industry, and we know what the ramifications that thereof was, but also saying others need to come and account. I wasn't the only one. What do you read in that?
As I see it, he always punched above his weight. I don't take Pravin Gordhan that seriously anyway. There are two historic facts that one should not forget, in my view. When the new South Africa in 1994 was formed, It did not have its own Minister of Finance. It did not have its own head of the Reserve Bank. The first Minister of Finance was a mining guy called Derek Keyes. And his follow-up was the guy, the former head of Nedbank. How that was ever possible under the ANC democracy is way beyond me. Then also what is important, the head of Chris Stals, with his track record of apartheid money from the Reserve Bank, how he ever got involved is again a big question mark. So why was the state capture not then brought up then already? Because it was clearly captured. And who does the vetting of particularly the treasury in this country? Is it the ANC-led government, or is it the private sector who has an interest in it? So what state capture are we talking about here today?
Okay, let's just, Tshepo Kadima joins us now on our outside broadcast pack. Mr. Kadima, thanks so much for your time. Do you think the grandstanding and political posturing was exposed today by the students?
Well, look, the question that I think hasn't been answered is what was the purpose of the lecture at the University of Johannesburg today? And without the purpose being clearly defined, when we look at the contents of really the two presentations by the former minister and his deputy, I don't see how anyone can believe what they say. Because when we look at their own legacy and their own tenure, there's absolutely no way that I think the things that they were saying can be believed. For example, I think there were a number of things that they could have perhaps maybe made us a lot more wiser. We have to bear in mind that between the year 2008 and 2016, this country, we racked up over 1 trillion rand in sovereign debt. And perhaps maybe Mr. Gordhan could have shared with the nation as to in those years that he was busy increasing our indebtedness, as currently is the case. Well, who were the banks that were advising on those debt offerings? How much money they got paid in fees? Who were the lawyers? And that account certainly can help us, because right now we are in a very deep financial crisis as well as a economic crisis. And they didn't really give any solutions going forward. And the reason why they couldn't give any solutions going forward, it only confirms what we have always alleged, or asserted rather, that they were clearly misplaced in the Ministry of National Treasury, and they were not the right people to be the jockeys for the economic horse of South Africa.
Yeah, let's talk about radical economic transformation. Sorry, Tshepo, in the interest of time, and the fact that the state levers could have been used more effectively to change the complexion of the economy, having more inclusive, smaller black players coming in. And in this case, Pravin Gordhan failed to respond to that question in his tenure. What has he done to change the economic landscape?
He couldn't do anything because he was not his own man. And the students, unfortunately for him, exposed him. They showed that they have a much more better appreciation of what the real issues are that needed to be addressed than the man who was actually heading our national treasury. As I say, that I think it was a miscalculated move on his part to have gone and engaged the students in the manner that he did. But if anything, he just confirmed that from day one, he should never have been the Minister of Finance.
All right, so your perspective, Sfiso, just in terms of the narrative again, will his, would you call it his speech? Because it has become synonymous with that. It's almost predictable as to what he will say. Will it hold water in future, in your view?
Well, I would have hoped that he would have aspired to save his legacy, to go and speak about unity and the ANC, and to cut some ribbons. And he does have a background from the South African receiver of revenue. He can speak on that. And no one is, you know, desiring to shut him out from this country. He'll maintain the fact that he's been a member of the ANC for a long time. But when you go after you have served in a position for many years and discredit everything about that, you're putting yourself on the line. I think South Africans must always remember, and I echo these words, that Mr. Pravin Gordhan was never appointed by President Jacob Zuma. We often hear about the Nene Gate. And what happened at the Nene Gate is that when Minister Nene was released, President Jacob Zuma appointed Mr. Des van Rooyen as the then Minister of Finance. President Jacob Zuma was met by the heads of business. We were informed over 30 heads of business to say you must release this man and appoint Pravin Gordhan. 3 days later, Mr. Pravin Gordhan was appointed. So he cannot have a good relationship with the ANC and President Jacob Zuma because he was never President Jacob Zuma's choice, notwithstanding that he became our Minister of Finance. But if he's going to give a lecture on state capture and give a lecture on white monopoly capital, I am very worrisome of anyone who wants to talk about white monopoly capital and state capture without mentioning the Ruperts and the Oppenheimers and the Ackermans, because they captured the state from day one. I need someone who's going to address the facts that a few families in this country have contracts with Eskom for over 30 and 40 years. I need someone to put on the table with content and fact that the mines in this country are not black owned. I want someone to come and say that My Way and all the other insurance companies in South Africa, not one of them are owned by a black person or a black family. So if anyone wants to talk about state capture, they need to talk about the real state capture and equate it back to 1994 and before. But if someone is perhaps grandstanding and mudslurring, they'll go and address a group of students and want to talk about one man and one organization and cast some aspersions on one family. It's very unfortunate because that is not factual.
Yeah, just very briefly, Mr. Fuza, in the, again, we're interested in the next generation, in how they will shape and mold this country going forward and protect our democracy. Is this indicative of a cohort or group of youngsters that are woke, that won't just buy any grandstanding from a podium from a former leader, as it were?
Well, students should always be very critical. That's their role. That's the nature of a student. If a student is not critical and it does not demonstrate and does not become angry and does not have any Sturm und Drang, as they say in German, if they don't have any fire in their blood, in their veins, then they'll be dead by the age of 30. So it's good what they did is to expose, to participate and throw the debate open, because it is actually seriously important that fired former pharmacist, Minister of Finance, Pravin Gordhan, and his deputy must be investigated thoroughly. We cannot get around that. These two people must be investigated in the inner circle within Treasury, and the students should push for that as well.
All right, we're going to leave it there, gentlemen. As always, thank you so much. Sifiso Mahlangu is political editor for ANN7 and TNA, and Udo Fruza, political commentator. Tsepo Hadima, thanks indeed. He's a political analyst joining us via our outside broadcast facility. For now, though, we take a quick ad break. We'll see you shortly.